Welcome to Jazz Forum. I'm Michael Fitzgerald, Electronic Services Librarian at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host. Our guest today is Jeffrey Sultanof. Jeff Sultanof is both a scholar and a practitioner. He's a veteran of the music publishing industry, an educator, and a passionate and knowledgeable advocate of jazz. Over the course of his career with Warner Brothers Music, Hal Leonard, and now Jazz Lines Publications, he has worked closely with major American composers and is responsible for some landmark publications, including the complete repertoire of the Miles Davis Birth of the Cool Nonet. Jeff's new book, Experiencing Big Band Jazz, A Listener's Companion, presents the history of the large ensemble and its composers, arrangers, and performers from before jazz existed to the present day. Welcome, Jeff.
Delighted to be here.
It's great to have you.
Thank you.
I thought we would start, and you're best known in the world of Jazz Insiders as a pioneering editor of big band arrangements from original manuscripts. Mm. And certainly we're going to talk about that, but I thought maybe we could start with, how did you arrive at that point? What's your background? What's your experience that got you there?
The simple answer is I wanted to be an arranger. I wanted to be an arranger conductor. I had records when I was 5 and 6 years old. I would look at the record labels and see such and such in his orchestra, and I had the idea that somebody was actually out there writing music and in front of a bunch of musicians and accompanying singers and doing all sorts of things, writing film scores. So I realized that I had a study. So the first big event for me was when I went to the Central Library in Jamaica, New York, and I realized that you could get a hold of scores of Beethoven symphonies, Brahms symphonies, and I borrowed them and I followed them with the records. And of course, the next thing I thought was, where are the scores for Frank Sinatra's arrangement of this particular song? And I came to understand that they just weren't around. And people would look at me very crazily, and they would just think that was very cute. So I was undaunted. Basically, when I was 18 years old, I started to go to music stores. At the time, they were still selling something called stock arrangements, where you actually put together, they were parts of a particular piece, and so I would write scores out. I had actually been doing that for my band director when I was in seventh grade. And eventually, I came upon companies that had the original material that was recorded. The Stan Kenton organization sold sets of things that had actually been recorded, and they didn't come with scores, so I was writing out scores, and I began to realize that a lot of these things had mistakes in them. And then segue to this, so I continued to do that on my own, and I subsequently did it for a number of composers on my own. People were asking me to do this. And then what happened was the era began where major band leaders, people who were contractors, began to donate this music. So I heard of places like the Institute of Jazz Studies. So little by little, whatever I could lay hands on, I wrote out scores, found mistakes, and was doing that on my own for a long time. And subsequent, after that, that came in handy, for instance, in doing the Miles Davis Birth of the Cool, because I happened to be at a publisher's office where the music had been reclaimed from storage. And we were going over it, and we saw all the Gil Evans arrangements that had been written for Miles, but we also found all of these miscellaneous parts. And luckily, I was working for Hal Leonard. Hal Leonard had a deal with Miles Davis. They said, what projects do you want to work on? And I said, we got to do this. We got to do this, because all of these pieces had been transcribed, and I knew from other transcribers that in a lot of cases, there were things that were just flat out wrong. So I was able to do that, and what is wonderful now is that I'm with a company that's what we do. 97% of what we put out comes from original manuscripts. And over the years, I've met a lot of my heroes, met a lot of the musicians that worked with these people. So that combined with information that I've learned from the people who were actually there. I had a mentor for 35 years who worked with Nat Cole, who worked for Nelson Riddle, or worked with Nelson Riddle. So as we were discussing at a different time, you amass a lot of information, and then when it comes to putting the jigsaw puzzle together, you can claim that and actually use it. And I'm very proud of what we've been doing. And the people that buy it like it a lot as well.
Yeah. You're talking about Jerry Graff.
Yes,
who,
absolutely.
Who you worked with for 35 years, and it's yes. going to be, next week will be 10 years since his passing.
Oh.
Talk a little bit about him.
He was my second father. I'm probably going to get a little emotional. That doesn't matter. I met him because he was living in the neighborhood that I was living in. He lived about 10 blocks away. My mother and his wife knew each other, and I was introduced to him on Father's Day, and this is actually a funny story that I love to tell, so it's a great opportunity to do it. Judy Graff, his wife, said, "You've got to meet Jerry, got to meet my husband, because I think he would like you." And I was 19 years old, and I was starving to get into the music business. Just trying to find a way to do it. So here's this man, he had been working the night before with the Barry sisters up in the Catskills. It was Father's Day, the whole family was going to a Broadway show. And he wasn't all that inclined to pay that much attention. But basically we were talking, something wasn't connecting. And he mentioned casually, I remember him sitting there eating scrambled eggs, and he's saying, "Well, I work for a company that's run by Chuck Goldstein." And I said, "Oh, Chuck Goldstein, he was one of the modern heirs." And suddenly, all of these eyes are looking up at me. He knows. So then he brings out a folder, which was a piece of promotion because the Chuck Goldstein office was doing jingles and commercials and whatever. And he said, "Do you know who that musician is? Do you know who that musician is?" And I would rattle off. He would say, "Well, this is Al Klink." I said, "Oh, yeah, he used to play with Glenn Miller." And then he said, "What are you doing this summer?" So to make a very, very long story short, basically what I know about vocal music is thanks to him, because before that I really didn't know how an act was structured. I didn't know very much about group singing. He played groups like the Pied Pipers, and subsequently I found records for him that he'd never heard. And eventually I became his orchestrator and his producer, which was a great compliment because he just didn't tolerate nonsense. He wouldn't have me do anything just because I was in his life. I had to be thoroughly professional. I had to know my business. So toward the end of his life, he made a CD. We recorded it out at Capitol Studios, and I produced it. There was a situation. He had written something for Lynn Roberts, and he didn't have an orchestrator. And I said, "Jerry, I'll do it. I'll do it for nothing," because I wanted to work with him. And we did it at Florida Atlantic University. And he said to me, he said, "Well, I can't use you all the time, but that, I'd made it. I'd made it as a professional arranger composer." And that was very important to me. So that was really my baptism with him. And yeah, he was like my father, and we were extremely close.
Over the course of the years, you know, you've had the opportunity to work with a number of other people. Who are some of the other people that were?
Oh yeah, you're getting me to name drop, and I don't mind doing that as long as, let's put it in context. I was very fortunate to be at the right places at the right time. I worked for Warner Brothers Publications, and then I worked for Hal Leonard. At Warner Brothers, I worked with Burt Bacharach. I didn't work directly with Michael Jackson, but we were doing his books. I didn't work directly with John Williams, but I was asked to do a brass quintet arrangement of the Liberty Fanfare. And he had to okay everything. And he okayed it, and not only did he okay it, we found out, oh, he really likes this. I worked with Ahmad Jamal. I worked with Jerry Mulligan toward the end of his life, where actually we worked very closely. We did two play-alongs together. And it was at the point, he was very ill at the time, and he found out that I knew a lot of the people that he'd listened to when he was in Philadelphia. The joke was, we were talking about big bands, and I mentioned Jan Savitt. Mm-hmm. And I just let it go, because before that, I didn't really want to talk about myself. That wasn't why I was there. So we used to have lunch every time I was there. So he started it. He said, how do you know who Jan Savitt is? So then I began to tell him. And then I said, you know, I was also a baritone saxophonist in my playing days. And I said, I'm going to say something that you may not like. You weren't my hero. The room stopped. Franca Mulligan, I could see making faces, and he had a couple of other assistants. He found that very humorous. And I had a very dear friend who was also his dear friend named Gene Lees. And Gene had said to me, you know, the guy has a great sense of humor, and you guys will really work well together. So he found that very humorous. He's looking at me and he's saying, well, who was your hero? And I said, Serge Chaloff. He said, well, his high register was flat. I said, yeah, well, I didn't play in the high register. And that started it, because after that, he would say, well, let's go and listen to this. And then, and I tell this to students, you don't go in and you don't expect somebody who doesn't know you to tell you their life story. So at that point, he trusted me. He also liked what I was doing musically, which was my main reason for being there. But suddenly he began to talk, and I began to understand what Jerry used to talk about was values. Every composer, every arranger, every creative artist has values. That where their art stems from, what's important to them. And it's important to understand what they are as much as you can. And if you have the opportunity to work with these people, maybe they don't articulate it, but the more you talk with them, and he and I would talk about his music. He would say to me, well, at the time I was learning counterpoint, and I wasn't thinking of chord names, because we were talking about something like that. And he said, you know, you're bringing something up. I never thought about it that way. I said, well, I understand that, and I'm not trying to complicate your life either. So that's the other thing that's nice about the work that I do with these other, with these various arrangers. Several of them I knew. So I understand their values. When I edit a score by Nelson Riddle, I know what he was looking to do. I know when he was trying to rush something out. You also learn various tendencies. If I wanted to, I could duplicate the way he wrote for strings, because he was remarkably consistent. So I look at this as, it's like archaeological work, but it's also, I love the fact, these people aren't alive anymore, but we're communicating, and that's very special to me.
Once you've done the archaeological work, once you've discovered some materials, that's not the end of the process. No. You can't just publish those. No. Talk a little bit about what happens next.
Okay, the scenario is we get, and Rob actually made a deal with the Ella Fitzgerald estate.
This is Rob Duboff.
Rob Duboff, who runs the company. His brother also is a co-owner, and he's more on the business side. So Rob will send me, let's say, a particular score. Happily, the Fitzgerald estate, they've got the score and the parts. The parts are what the individual pieces of paper that the musicians actually play from. What happens very often, and actually I've said this repeatedly, there isn't one score that I've ever seen that has not had at least one mistake in it. Sometimes they're buried, sometimes they're blatant. Basically, what can happen is any number of things. when it's copied, there's a mistake that's made. It's not caught at the session. Sometimes the notation is written in a way that is not the easiest way to read it. So that what I discuss as far as that's concerned is, you know, language. A word is spelled usually one way, maybe two. Music doesn't work that way. A rhythm can be written four and five different ways sometimes. A very good arranger doesn't necessarily have the background to write it the easiest, cleanest way. So we look for things like that. We also look for things that will make something easier to play. Respelling chords. I don't want to get too technical here, but some singers sing in some keys that are rather complex, like the key of B has five sharps, D flat or whatever. In some cases, I've seen Gil Evans scores where every note is sharp. Mm-hmm. And then you have to look at it and say, well, when we write parts for the reeds, suddenly it gets extremely complicated. So we sort of have to do it another way. And Rob has now been editing for 25 years. He's one of the best editors I've ever seen. I've been doing this for 40. So sometimes we get on the phone and we just go back and forth, and sometimes there is no right answer. So the basic answer is we clean it up to make sure it's as perfect as it can be, because usually it isn't. We make it so that people can read it without too much hassle, and we do it that it's laid out, it's comfortable for the player. Player enjoys looking at it, likes playing from it. And ultimately, they look at something from Jazz Lines, they know it's going to be quality.
And this, I mean, this really sort of is the answer to your prayer as a young student. You know, how can I get my hands on this music? And I think it sort of ties into what you've done with the book, which is, you know, again, working in some ways as an educator, in some ways as an advocate, and sort of drawing on all your experience. Yeah. Let's talk about the book a little. And it's in some ways, it's a history, but it's only looking at big band jazz.
Yes.
But it's also set up thinking about the current audience and how they get to their music.
The publisher continues to look to add to a series called Experiencing. This could be Mozart, this could be Led Zeppelin, this could be Chick Corea. I suggested a big band jazz book. I knew it was going to be a particular genre. I don't want to say the word restrictive, but it was only going to cover a certain type of big band. The more I thought about it, the more I said, well, first of all, they wanted something for novices, which makes total sense because, as you know, I write frequently for scholars, and that's great, but they already know this, or they already know that they want to know more about it. Given the circumstances of the way we are now, people just don't get a chance to listen to big bands. So they had asked for a book for the novice, so I said, well, how are we going to do this so that it draws the novice in? So I thought about it a long time, and I said, well, let's take these particular recordings. Let's make them available, because thank goodness we have YouTube. Because in the past, a book like this would come with a set of CDs, a set of cassettes or whatever, and the licensing would be absolutely impossible. At one time, the Smithsonian had their own label, and because it was a governmental agency, getting the rights to these things was very easy. Well, that ended. So the music was out there. Put it in a context, which is my big word, context. What does that mean? Make it inviting. So you give a little history. You introduce a particular band. You tell them, and the book has, what was it, who wrote it, where was it recorded? And one friend of mine was very kind. He said, it's like going to an art museum and you get one of these things that you carry around and you put numbers in and it gives you an explanation. So I gave a basic explanation and I give times. So the alto saxophone section comes in playing a paraphrase of the original, and that occurs at 1 minute, 10 seconds. And then in the middle of all of that, you include, what I was saying was, you include history. But you don't make it obnoxious. I'm not a show-off. The other thing that I wanted to do was, there was no big band book that wasn't, that was available at the time, that wasn't a fan book. Right. This is a book that you want to listen to the music. This is the music. This is not a nostalgic exercise. This is not anything else, but this is the music. I was actually, and I say this in here, I was originally thinking of the student who was in a big band or who was in a middle school or high school and maybe had some exposure to this and would want to know more about it. So that was the format that I proposed. It's turning out that that seems to be the best format possible, and readers from all levels are really enjoying it, so it's nice to know I made the right decision.
I think, you know, it has that appeal for those who are just getting started in the area of big band jazz, but also for those, you know, people that have been listening to it and are, you know, scholars or you know, very familiar with the music. There's artists that are covered in here that they don't get a mention in other history books. And it's what I found is that you make the connection to show how important that particular piece is and how it connects with, you know, music that happened before, music that happened after, and they really understand that artist's place in the continuum. You know, one of the things I saw in that you've got things on Tiny Khan. That's you don't find that mentioned anywhere else.
Because, well, first of all, this is the perfect forum to do it. If you're going to write a book on the big bands, of course, each person is going to do it differently. The nice thing about doing this for as long as I have is that I had a short list of people who I thought really needed to be in here, regardless of whether people knew of them or didn't. Now, you mentioned Tiny Khan. For anybody who's watching, he was a drummer. He died at the age of 30, but this is a man who, as an arranger, Johnny Mandel, who wrote The Shadow of Your Smile and won Grammy Awards and Emmy Awards and Oscars, he said Tiny Khan was the most talented of all of us. Wow. And for that to be left out, you know, as I said, this is the perfect forum for that. Because, yeah, you need to include certain people. They've got to be there. That's important. But this is also an opportunity to discuss many people that you wouldn't necessarily come upon. The one person in there that I'm thrilled that I was able to write about was the pianist, arranger, band leader, Chris McGregor, who came from South Africa and who had a band called the Brotherhood of Breath. And you could not find the recordings here. They were not easy to find. He made several albums, but he died of cancer at the age of 90. And he was just about starting to... He'd been doing it since the early 70s. Right. Imagine this guy is leading a band on and off for 20 years, and each time he puts a band together, he can't find work, so then he's forced to take work elsewhere, and then he forms a new edition. And what's particularly fascinating about him is that this is urban music. This is music, South African chants. It's derived from South African chants. And we talk about world music. Here was somebody who was utilizing world music in a big band format. There's another band in here that's performing now, a man named Spock Frevo, who's drawing from Brazilian sources. And this is a band that does tour, has performed in New York, but he's utilizing people from his area of the world. And they're doing something that nobody else is doing, but in a way is perfectly natural for them. So there are all of these threads and things that, you know, yeah, the big band was the popular music of the 40s, but when it stopped, it didn't stop being a creative ensemble.
And you know, because you have the, you know, the technical background, I think you've been perceptive enough to identify, you know, what's significant and what's interesting. But the book is not presented in technical terms.
No.
There's no music notation in it at all. Like you said, you know, you identify things by, you know, minutes and seconds, so someone who's watching on YouTube can easily see, oh, you know, that's what you're talking about.
Right.
And I think that improves their ears.
Yes, absolutely.
So when they get done, they're smarter.
There's a lot of ear training. And again, these were areas that I didn't realize were ultimately going to be part of the experience. But the more I looked at it, I actually reread it before it went to press. And I said, you know, when somebody goes through this, if they really go through it, they're going to have a very good new set of sensibilities in hearing. And that's fabulous, because you're bringing listening to another level.
And how's the book been received?
The book has, thank goodness, been received very well. I've gotten some beautiful reviews. The Amazon webpage has 4 people that reviewed it that have actually given it ratings. There are different people who've actually posted it on blogs and things. Very gratifying. 1 or 2 people that had a couple of issues, but you know what? That's great, because everybody looks at it from their own perspective. At the same time, those same people understand why certain decisions were made. But yeah, it's extremely gratifying.
And it's been adopted as a textbook at
University of North Texas,
so that's,
which is like that's like an Academy Award in our field. It's when I found that out, and I've known the gentleman who runs the jazz studies area. We have been talking for a number of years, not about this, but about the historical music. But he was saying to me, this fits in perfectly with one of the courses that he's teaching. And
wonderful.
Doesn't get better than that.
Our guest today on Jazz Forum has been Jeffrey Sultanof, composer, arranger, educator, and author of the new book, Experiencing Big Band Jazz, A Listener's Companion. Jazz Forum is a production of the Felix E. Grant Jazz Archives and the Jazz Studies Program at the University of the District of Columbia. If you'd like more information about the Felix E. Grant Jazz Archives or the Jazz Studies Program at UDC, please visit our website at www.jazzarchives.org. I'm Michael Fitzgerald. Thanks for watching. See you next time.